In 1986, young people in Poland could enjoy a true cornucopia of amazing works that, along with the classics of the previous epochs, would leave a lasting mark on their imagination. The cinemas were showing Return of the Jedi. Tolkien's Silmarillion was finally available, published in 1985 in the iconic translation by Maria Skibiniewska. The year 1986 also brought the FIFA World Cup in Mexico with its uplifting spirit and excitement. But it was also the year when the Chernobyl nuclear power plant exploded, thus defining human responsibility for nature anew. A phenomenon typical of the Polish reading market in the 80s was the press. In those seemingly great times, Poles could choose from a range of magazines responding to the various interests of readers from the earliest ages up. Each new issue was very much sought after, and so it was advisable to build a good relationship with the lady at the kiosk in order to get them from under the counter. Indeed, a true social network was formed with no phones, no internet, by those who would share, lend, exchange, or give them journals. That's how I came into possession as a gift from a family friend of the earliest edition of an exceptional magazine that accompanied me to my adulthood on a regular basis, namely Fantastica, the literary monthly whose editors were providing readers with works by the titans of science fiction and fantasy, including Philip K. Dick, Kirk Buichov, and many others from both sides of the Iron Curtain. Fantastica was also open for debutantes. And so, at the end of the 1986, in the December issue, readers for the first time met a protagonist who was soon to change not only the literary but also the cultural landscape of Poland and beyond. His name was Geralt, and he was a witcher, Wiedźmin. This was also the title of the short story published in Fantastica by Andrzej Sapkowski, the creator of Geralt and his universe. To make a long story short, being a witcher is a profession. Its practitioners travel all around the world being hired to slay monsters. In the cycle of Geralt's adventures, Sapkowski made a veil of the heritage of Slavic, Celtic, and German mythologies, as well as the Arthurian legends, fairy tale folk tradition, and references to numerous masterpieces of culture, including the popular culture of the 80s, which altogether later earned him the label of postmodernist writer. However, this literary practice based on references to the world heritage is akin to the millennia-old tradition of emulatio and imitatio, the approach used by ancient artists both to prove their own mastery and to pay homage to their predecessors. This practice is also very rewarding for readers, as they are encouraged and even expected to make connections. And the more they know, memorize, and associate, the greater enjoyment they draw from this intertextual game designed by the storyteller. As a child in the 80s, I perceived Sapkowski's works exactly in these terms, as an amazing tale from a great storyteller, a tale similar to the fables and myths from an earlier reading, including Greek mythology. And of course, this aspect of our cultural heritage is also present in the Witcher universe. Though it's less often noticed, it gives many precious hints and thereby helps to understand this universe better, including its ecological message. Jan Parandowski, who is the author of the very famous in Poland mythology of Greek and Romance, once said that everything happened in childhood. And that certainly goes for Sapkowski. The childhood of the writer, as we learn from the interview with Stanisław Beresz, was quite similar to King Arthur's, according to T.H. White in his Sword and the Stone novel. Sapkowski's too was a childhood among animals, spent under the wise guidance of his grandfather in a role of, let's say, Merlin. Even though he was born in Łódź, the industrial city not far away from Warsaw, His grandfather provided him with holidays and excursions in regular contacts with nature, and these contacts, as he admits, shaped him for his adulthood. As for his writer's workshop, Sapkowski emphasizes that individualism is vital, yet he adds that one should also learn from whomever they can, but especially from the classics. Indeed, in the fandom, there are legends about his wide reading list and his fluency in several languages, but it all started in the pre-reading era when he was 5 and was read the classics aloud by his father. In particular, Sapkowski indicates Homer as one of his masters. Moreover, Sapkowski undertakes a mission to refresh the reader's knowledge of mythology, thus proving how important it is to him. In the book Manuscript, Discovered in a Dragon's Cave, he offers a crash course on Greek myths. He begins with the statement that, I quote, there was only chaos in the beginning, end of quote, and then asks a seemingly rhetorical question, again a quotation, who would be able to say just what chaos was, end of quotation. But there is an answer, because also here a quotation is hidden. The writer explains, I quote, well, the one who can do this is Professor Jan Parandowski, from whose mythology I took the above quote. You should read about what happened in Hellas later, after chaos, from Jan Parandowski. So Sapkowski refers his readers to the mythology published back in 1924, which for decades has been obligatory reading at Polish schools. Along with the Bible in the national epic poem Pan Tadeusz by Adam Mickiewicz, it has therefore been forming the minds of Poles. Sadly, Parandowski's twilight has begun, as his work is no longer required at the elementary school level. Nonetheless, Sapkowski, with his typical perspicacity, encourages his fans to return to this very special book that forms a community of cultural experiences. Another quotation. Only in fable survives what cannot survive in nature. Only myths and fables do not know the limits of possibility, says the Witcher to the dragon in the short story, The Bounds of Reason. These words would also offer food for thought in many aspects, but in my short presentation, I will limit myself only to indicating a few directions in relation to classical reception and mythology. In the 1986 issue of Fantastica, we see Geralt in the illustration by Grzegorz Komorowski, who proposed a silhouette alluding to Don Quixote. The Witcher holds a lance and there is a bird flying nearby. Indeed, it seems that in this very first visual representation of Geralt, the illustrator succeeded in capturing the essence of his paradoxical character. Sapkowski creates a hero who is an anti-hero. His profession dates to the times when the people were intruders and had to fight for every piece of land against dragons, werewolves, elves, and griffins. The monsters were slain by the witchers. But this fact paves the way for broad ecological thinking, as human laws, needs, and rights clash with those of other creatures. The dragon explains that the creatures used to be called monsters for some time now have felt increasingly threatened by people. They can no longer cope on their own. They need a protector. Geralt doesn't intend to be a protector, but in practice he does protect many beings considered monstrous, including the dragon. Geralt's decisions result also from his personal painful experiences, as the witches are perceived as monsters by the society that both needs and fears them. Thus, according to Sapkowski, ecology has a broad meaning and it involves searching for an answer to what humanity means. It concerns the issue of respect for anybody we may define as other. Also important factor, Sapkowski emphasizes the question of balance and mutual dependencies. The crimes of people against the natural environment also put their own lives at risk. New mutants appear and all of nature rebels. The dire prophecy of the white cold begins to come true, a climatic catastrophe that is to put an end to the known world. Of course, today we know that it's not glaciation, a theory still popular in the 70s and in the 80s, that's the problem, but the very opposite, global warming. But this is only a change in name, not in substance. More and more scholars and journalists notice in the Witcher universe a mirror for the environmental problems of our times. One of the aspects of this diagnosis manifests itself in the short story A Little Sacrifice. Sapkowski plays here with the Homeric myth of the siren and Hans Christian Andersen's Little Mermaid. It should be noticed that the Polish language does not differentiate these creatures. Geralt features in the story in a strange role of a translator between a mermaid and a human prince. This prince is madly in love with the mermaid. However, the relationship, one promising to change the problem of the other, gets complicated when it turns out that the prince wishes his future wife to have human legs instead of scaly tail, so he proposes an elixir to her that would make this painful transformation happen. At this point, Sapkowski shows the perspective of the mermaid, who for her part proposes that the sea witch transforms the prince. He should give up the legs that the mermaid finds very unattractive and to develop an elegant tail, fin and everything like a Norman triton. What ensues is a stalemate that makes readers rethink the stereotypes. The situation gets even more complicated when fishermen who sail further than usual are killed in a mysterious way. No one knows what happened, but the mermaid gets suspected and the prince orders Geralt to solve the case. The Witcher doesn't want to interfere with the sea creatures and he suggests keeping to the boundaries. The ancient hubris is well audible in the prince's reply, I quote, "We will check what's on the other side of the ocean, if there's anything at all, and we will get from that ocean all that is possible to take. And if not us, then our grandchildren or the grandchildren of our grandchildren. It's just a matter of time. Yes, we will do it, even if ocean would need to turn red with blood." End of quotation. Geralt knows that such people cannot be stopped. A ray of hope is cast, however, by the happy ending of the story. The mermaid comes to the palace on the two legs she obtained from the sea witch. The prince is truly delighted, and we know that in his very special way, he truly loves her. So the destruction of the sea kingdom is not imminent, but we also know that it is not prevented forever. It's only postponed in time. Similar ecological issues regard the kingdom of the Dryads in the short story The Sword of Destiny, with the motif of the forest resonating with Professor Jankiniewicz's lecture. Meanwhile, the transcendental experience of nature is the lot of Geralt, his friend, a poet, and other characters from the story The Edge of the World. In this story, we encounter a Sylvanus sharing threats with Pan, Faun, and the amicable devil Rokita from Polish folklore. The creature helps the elf survive in the human world. In the midst of a bloody struggle between Geralt, the poet, and the elves, the Queen of Fields, the Eternal One, manifests herself. By her very presence, all quarrels end. She telepathically tells the elves of hope and the eternal renewal of nature. The elements of the Golden Age motif come to the fore. The antagonists experience a mystical feeling of community despite all the differences between them. We learn also that the Queen of Fields will remain if the people prove worthy, just like the Hesiodic goddess Astraea. The mythological thread is further developed by the evocation of Arcadia. The Sylvanus starts squealing fiercely on a strange pipe he made of pieces of reeds of various lengths, a pan's flute, of course. The poet joins with a lute he has just received from the elves, and together they form a strange transhuman duet, beautifully resonating with the spirit of community. But like in ancient Arcadia, the serene atmosphere is only an illusion, or rather a short calm period to enjoy before the dark clouds come and the death declares at Inarcadia Ego. This peaceful part of the land will soon be hit by a terrible war, again a disaster caused by the greedy humans. What remains is the hope that the Eternal One will manifest herself again, so little and so much. Myths and fables do not know the limits of possibility, but there is one more realm where this rule applies, childhood, with all its hopes and chances for transformations, even in the darkest moments and against reason, against all odds. Young people are not the main target of Sapkowski's work, touching many mature themes, but storytelling, which is a trademark of Sapkowski as an author, knows no age divisions, and neither myths nor fairy tales are easy and safe. Maybe that's why the Witcher universe was and remains so appealing to young people, building their identity in relation to adults, peers, civilization, and nature. Sapkowski has much to offer from the perspective of the coming of age process. His characters are multidimensional. There are no easy answers to their dilemmas, no didacticism in solving problems. The world is on the verge of ecological catastrophe, and the bitter irony appears when the emotional load is too heavy to cope with. We observe that something ends, something begins before our very eyes, both in Geralt's universe and in our world. There is also a girl who can change the odds, Geralt's child of destiny, but this is a topic for another story. If there is hope, it is in the salvific power of art, as also Sapkowski's book attests to, and in children who through contact with art and nature can make a change. Thank you very much for your attention.